traditionally had an issue with trying to get workers to work in the factories. The workers are generally located in the rural areas, and because of the hukou laws, the restrictions about migrations within the country, a lot of the migrant workers show up in the factories without places to live and without any other sort of support. And so right now with the coronavirus, it's even more difficult because the travel restrictions had been much more severe in China, and that has limited the supply of labor going into the key areas, for example, Shenzhen. And on top of that, many of the key areas that need labor, like Shenzhen, which is the innovation center for China, the price of residential housing has become skyrocketing to the point where people just can't afford to even buy a place to live.
Wow. Well, manufacturing, and much of it is being driven by foreign demand, export growth topping expectations for 8 of the last 9 months. What does all of this mean for China's economy and its position globally once these vaccines take hold? We turn the corner on the pandemic. It seems as though China has a head start when it comes to economies.
Well, China really has a huge challenge of nuancing its manufacturing. For several years now, the low value-added manufacturing has been moving out of China to Vietnam and other places in ASEAN and other parts of Asia, Eastern Europe, and even Latin America. But what China has to do and is planning to do, part of its five-year plan, is to move up the value-added chain and to manufacture goods and services that are higher value-added, that generate higher income, provide higher paying jobs for its citizens. And to enable it to do that, we have to shift from the less educated workforce to a more educated workforce. And a lot of this comes about through innovations that are not just in manufacturing and industry, but also innovations in the service sector.
Can we talk a little bit about the contrast we're witnessing? Because, you know, you've got factory managers in China saying that they're hiking wages by 25% because of this demand for workers. At the same time, here in the United States, we're seeing this quibbling on Capitol Hill about whether people should get $600 or $2,000 stimulus checks because there's so much suffering, so many people out of work. It's quite a dichotomy, and it's not just the U.S., a lot of Western countries in Europe as well, pumping money into the consumers' wallets because of this pandemic. What are we seeing here?
Well, one thing we see in China is that because manufacturing is booming and there's a demand for workers, the need for economic support is much less. People can actually get jobs if they can get to the locations and actually generate income with which to spend. Here in the United States, because of the administrative lockdowns in all parts of the economy, people just cannot get to work. And because of that, they need economic support, and that support is being debated as to how much support and whatnot. In Europe, you see much more in the way of explicit support for laid-off workers, and here in the United States, much less so. China, as I said, has that advantage of being able to still have the economy generate the work that produces the income. Now, for China, as I said, it has the nuance from the low value-added jobs that it currently has to very high value-added jobs, and that is a shift in the workforce that is trying to transition without having to generate a lot of unemployment.
William, when you do a deep dive into the factory numbers, another thing that pops out at you is China's bicycle industry is on fire, best numbers in a decade. Consumers want the exercise bikes because they're all stuck at home. And those that do go to work, you were talking about getting to work, many would rather take a bike than get on public transportation. What are some of the things that you see in the numbers that kind of jump out at you?
Well, what I've noticed is that China has also tried to get green, and a lot of the industries are trying to shift its manufacturing toward more green processes, and that also involves having to shift manufacturing in a way that causes unemployment in some sectors like coal mining and generates more demand in areas like bicycles and electric cars. So I think the nuancing of the manufacturing transformation of China is something that the five-year plan is trying to address, but also is challenged by the need for innovations and spurring innovations, both, as I said, in the service sector and in the manufacturing sector, but innovations in a way that allows experimentation to fail. And that's where China really has to pick up the role of inspiring innovations, allowing them to fail, and having bankruptcy laws and procedures that allow a failed business to either restructure or shift its resources away to other more successful areas.
Yeah, so obviously a mixture of challenges and opportunities. William Lee, thanks so much for your observations. Really appreciate it.